Here we go. 1 Timothy 2:1-8. I'm starting a new series. Yeah, I really goofed Denise up. She typed a bulletin off and thought I was continuing on in Psalms. But I know, you know, Pastor Coyne, he was laid out years ahead of time, and he knew exactly everything.
It took him years to get through a book.
Yeah, well... So I was praying about, you know, a new series or stay in the Psalms, and because I had preached that New Year's sermon last week about prayer and a commitment, a new renewed commitment towards prayer in my life, I began to look at more and more Bible passages dealing with prayer, and I really feel that the Lord wants me to launch into a series on prayer. Now, a lot of you might think, oh, it'll be 5-6 weeks, but the more you start looking at passages, both Old and New Testament on prayer, it is. Here's just a couple of the ideas. Prayer for beginners. I wanted to have a sermon dealing with kind of the very basics of prayer. Prerequisites for answered prayer. That's a good title, isn't it? John 17, Christ's high priestly prayer, what we commonly call the Lord's Prayer. We can work our way through that. It really isn't the Lord's Prayer, it's the disciples' prayer, but we'll look at that. James says, the effective, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. What does it mean to have an effective prayer? We can look at the prayer life of Daniel, the prayer life of kind of a conversational, as he walked along, as he built the wall. Nehemiah's prayer life is very interesting in the book of Nehemiah. So I got all kinds of, every one of Paul's epistles, almost every one of them, Paul's, as his introduction, he says, I mention you in my prayer, praying, and then he says what he's praying for the various groups, you know? So there's bunches and bunches of passages that we're going to attempt to look at dealing with prayer. This is one, I think, kind of an introductory one. That's why I jumped onto this one for this week. This is in 1 Timothy chapter 2, verses 1 through 8, dealing with prayer. But before we jump into that, I have set my jokes aside, and I've gone to historical facts. There's always some interesting historical facts, you know? I had that one a couple weeks ago about how the Pharaoh would always have somebody smeared with honey close to him so all the flies would go to that guy and not to the Pharaoh. So I thought I could smear Eugene with honey or something and then the flies won't land. That's just an interesting historical fact. This was kind of interesting. This is a very famous painting. It was painted by Arnold Freiberg, I guess. The Prayer at Valley Forge, and it shows George Washington kneeling in prayer. Well, there have been a lot of people, Christians often say, well, our country was based on Christian principles, and we find references to God and the Bible, and Christianity is a foundation of our country. And there's a lot of people who say, well, those early founders, they were agnostics, and they were theists, and they really weren't Christians. And this painting has been criticized and as saying, well, George Washington wouldn't have done that. Well, there's kind of a big controversy over that. So I looked this up. So what are the facts surrounding the prayer at Valley Forge, that painting? Well, here. The story, allegedly, now I got this off the internet, and this author is being very candid because, you know, is this provable? I don't know, and he don't know. So that's why he uses the word allegedly. But allegedly originated from a young man named Isaac Potts, who is a supposed eyewitness of the event of George Washington praying, kneeling in the woods during the winter of Valley Forge. You remember that historical winter when it was very tough on our troops, and then finally they crossed the Potomac, and we won a great victory over the British there. It is said that Potts was riding along one day when he came across General Washington hidden in the woods and caught up in deep prayer. Potts later revealed his experience to his pastor, Reverend Nathaniel Snowden. No relation, I think, to the Snowden that's famous today. But here is an excerpt. Here's an excerpt from Snowden's journal. As a pastor, he kept the journal. Isaac Potts was not part of the army. He was a farmer that lived in the area, happened to be going out in the woods, and come across General Washington on his knees praying. Well, here's what the pastor had recorded of Isaac Potts' story. I tied my horse to a sapling and I went quietly into the woods, and to my astonishment, I saw the great George Washington on his knees alone, with his sword on one side and his cocked hat on the other. He was at prayer to the God of the armies, beseeching to interpose with his divine aid, as it was ye Christ. Of course, this was written in the language that they were speaking back then. As it was ye Christ, and the cause of the country, of humanity, and of the world. He goes on, he says, such a prayer I never heard from the lips of man. I left him alone praying. I went home and told my wife. So he was very much affected by finding General George Washington on his knees out in the woods praying. I think this lends a lot of historical truth to the fact that George Washington was a Christian who was seeking the Lord's help during the battles of our Revolutionary War. I found that interesting as I was doing some reading on that. Okay, let's jump into our text. Oh, that's the site I had found it on. Okay, 1 Timothy chapter 2, verses 1 through 8. I will read through those, not no 29 verses like we had last week. Jump into this. Let me read this for you. Paul starts here in chapter 2. I urge then, first of all, that requests, prayers, intercession, and thanksgiving be made for everyone, for kings and all those in authority, that we may live peaceful and quiet lives in all godliness and holiness. This is good and pleases God our Savior, who wants all men to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. For there is one God and one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself as a ransom for all men, the testimony given in its proper time. And for this purpose, I was appointed a herald and an apostle. I am telling the truth, I am not lying, and a teacher of the true faith to the Gentiles. I want men everywhere to lift up holy hands in prayer without anger or disputing. And of course the text goes on, but I'm going to end there with my passage today. All right, so I have five questions about prayer. I don't know if you picked up a sheet about the sermon. I have left some significant blanks there for you to try to follow. They're not on here yet. I will pick them up as we go through. I find, you know, if I give you my outline ahead of time, you quick write them down and then you can go to sleep. But if I leave them, then you have to fill them in as you got to stay awake throughout the whole thing. Okay, this is a passage about prayer, one of the most significant passages in Paul's writing, though he has many of them about prayer. He's talking to Timothy. I'll talk about that in just a minute. Prayer is one of the Christian disciplines. If you want to stay in shape, we discipline ourselves to exercise. We walk, or we walk on a treadmill, or we ride bike, or whatever it is. We eat properly. We eat properly, you know? Well, the Christian life has disciplines to it as well. One of the fruit of the Spirit is self-control, or that could be translated self-discipline. We need to discipline ourselves to get into God's Word and read. We need to discipline ourselves for prayer. And we need to discipline ourselves to be witnesses for the Lord Jesus Christ. Self-discipline means that we, even when we don't emotionally feel like it, we go ahead and do it anyway. Prayer is an important self-discipline, a discipline of the Christian life. So we're going to talk about that for a number of weeks. I don't know how many weeks, probably till next summer sometime. I'm guessing sometime like that. Okay, in this message, I will ask and I will answer five questions about prayer from this particular passage. Okay, so here we are. Question number one. What priority should we put on prayer? What priority should we put on prayer? Okay, is it how important does God see prayer? Well, look at verse 1. Paul says, I urge then, first of all, that requests, prayers, intercession, and thanksgiving be made for everyone. Okay, now how does that show us priority? Well, some comments. Paul sent Timothy, as you remember, Paul would travel around, but many times Paul would be imprisoned, or many times Paul was at a certain place, and other churches were having some discipline, some problems. And Paul would send some of his young men that he was discipling, Titus, there's a whole list of them. Timothy was one of them. Paul sent Timothy to Ephesus because Ephesus was having some difficulties. And as you go through the book of 1 Timothy, you find some indications of what some of those problems they were having was. Paul sent Timothy there to help get these problems straightened around. Okay? Now, Paul is starting here in this verse. He is starting a list of steps that Timothy should take to get that local church on track. Okay? So we do that. All right, kids, I want you today, you're home from school. I want you to, number one, clean your room. Number two, I want you to straighten the basement out. Number three, I want you to get your dirty clothes and throw them in a hamper, whatever, you know? We have lists of things like that. Paul is instructing Timothy in this chapter, especially in verse 1. He starts his list because he says, first of all, Timothy, okay? So he starts his list. In this verse, he is starting a list of steps that Timothy should take to get the local church on track. He starts by telling Timothy the church needs to set prayer as the number one thing. I get up in the morning and I sit there and I think, all right, what do I got to do today? And I start making my mental list. Sometimes I write it down, but I make my mental, I need to write it down more often because I forget things on my list. But I'll start making my mental list of things I got to do today. And I usually start with the most important things and then work my way down. And then the less important things, you know, they get farther down the list. Paul says, first of all, Timothy, I sent you here to get the problems of this local church straightened around. Number one, the very first priority is that local church needs to start praying. Prayer is set as a very high priority in our lives, in a local church and in our lives individually. Prayer is very important. And many times, the important things get pushed back. I remember taking reading a book and taking a seminar on time management. And they were saying the important things get replaced with the, what was the word they used? I lost it. Immediate things, maybe, something like that. In other words, there's things that are there that want us to do them and do, and we take care of those, and the important things get pushed to the back, you know, get left undone because we're handling all of these immediate things. We need to set priorities and get the important things done in our lives. The important thing, Paul tells Timothy, first of all, Timothy, that church needs to begin to pray. Prayer should be a very high priority in our lives. This morning I got up. I don't know if that's the number one priority, but the first thing I did was go get me a cup of coffee. Maybe that is. Maybe the other number one in my life. I listened to our daily devotions. I usually listen on my phone to Our Daily Bread. Read the passage they had, and then I spent some time in prayer. I try to do that every day. I have long drives. This week, school starting back. I got 2 days a week up to Big Rapids. Hour drive, pulling out of my driveway, pulling into the College of Business, is 1 hour. Pretty close to exactly an hour. I spend much of that time in prayer. Prayer needs to be a priority in our lives. We need to find the time to do that. Yes, I can drive and pray at the same time. I'm not taking my eyes off the road, and I don't text the Lord. I keep my eyes on the road, but I spend that time in prayer. Prayer. So it needs to be a very high priority. Acts 2, the church begins. Day of Pentecost, the Holy Spirit comes upon them. They begin the church. Acts chapter 2. Later on, it went out to the Gentiles. We have the whole book of Acts. But in Acts chapter 2, the church begins. What did they set as priorities? Acts 2:42 says this. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching, so Bible doctrine, Bible teaching, and to fellowship. Notice that that is important to them. Talking with one another, fellowshipping with one. We think of fellowship as just a potluck where we can talk, you know, but fellowship is our getting together and encouraging and helping and interacting with one another. Fellowship, the breaking of bread, and prayer. Now, the breaking of bread, it's often been debated, is that talking about the Lord's table formally? Or many Bible expositors believe that's talking about that they ate together regularly and then had the Lord's table while they were eating together regularly. So, the apostles' doctrine, fellowship, eating together, and notice what else is included there. Prayer was a regular practice of the early church. Number of months back, Connie came to Pastor Coyne and says, I wonder if we can have some prayer time after church. And when John said, yeah, that'd be good, that's important, I said to myself, yeah, that really is. You know, we cannot neglect that. That time that we have after church, I know it's just a few minutes, but we mentioned some prayer requests. We pray for our leadership. We pray for God's guidance. I think that that is an important time because prayer needs to be a priority in a local church. Prayer needs to be an important time, a priority in your individual life. Think about your life. What priority does it have? Do things, demands, the immediate push prayer to a lesser priority in your life? Think about that. Question number 2, what is prayer made up of? Well, kind of interesting. The Apostle Paul just starts throwing these words at Timothy. He says, first of all, I urge then, first of all, that, and he begins telling Timothy that requests, prayers, intercession, and thanksgiving be made for everyone. Okay, so Paul starts off and gives a list there. He's talking about, he throws in a bunch of words related to prayer. Well, I went back, tried to do some study on these words. The four words that the Apostle Paul uses here. First one, he says request. The Greek word is, and I've transliterated it over into the English, deesis. Prayers asking God for help. One of the commentators said it is a word that implies desperation. You're on an icy road. Something comes out in front of you. You put your foot on the brake. The car starts sliding sideways, and you say, "God help me!" You know, desperation prayers. So, Paul says, first of all, Timothy, one of the things as they go to prayer, they need to cry out those needs that are really weighing heavily on their heart. Those things that they cry out in desperation. One of our prayer requests is we need to trust the Lord to help us with those hard times when we are in deep desperation. We need to bring requests to the Lord. Lord, help me with this. Many times these are about our own life. You know, Lord, I need this. Lord, I need help here. Although not necessarily only about our own life. Lord, so-and-so is really, really hurting. Please help them. So the first word, deesis, prayers asking God for help, requests, and implied in there is that they are somewhat desperate prayers, prayers when we are in great need. Secondly, he uses the word prosuke, kind of a general word for prayer. He says, first of all, requests, and then prayers. Prayers ought to be made. But several of the commentaries I was reading about this is a word used for prayers as one of the acts of worship. When we worship God, there are various things we can do. Serving God, getting into His Word, singing. You know, there are things that we can do to worship God. And that's what this word seems to be a part of. So worship needs to be a part of our prayer life. I try to start off my prayer time by praising God. I'll spend 3, 4, 5 minutes talking about some of the attributes of God. God, You are holy. God, You are merciful. I think of some of those verses in the Psalms that talks about He is merciful. He is slow to anger. Praying back the attributes to God is worship to Him. Go to the book of Revelation. Read some of those passages where the angelic creatures are worshiping the Lord. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. And just that was in Isaiah 6, but there are other ones in the book of Revelation. They worship the Lord. Worship needs to be a part of our prayer life. You know, kind of like you go to your boss and you want a raise, and do you walk right in and say, "Hey, boss, I want a raise"? No, you got to go in and you got to talk to him, and you got to. We used to get together a lot with Pastor Jose and some of the Spanish people. And Pastor Jose says, especially in the Spanish culture, and somewhat even in our culture, when they get together and they talk about things, they don't jump right into the business of what they want to talk about. They do straw first. They got the Spanish word. They do straw. In other words, they talk about things first. You know. Now I'm not implying worship is just straw, but when we come to the Lord, you know, we always think of prayer as asking for things. So many times when we come to prayer, we simply jump right in and start asking things. Lord, I need help with this. I need help with this. I need help with this. And we exclude worship in our prayer. Worship needs to be a major part of our prayer. Worship is expressing our faith in God's abilities, though He tells us to bring our request to Him. Yes, that should be a part of it. But worship should be a part of our prayer life as well. How much time do you spend in your prayer life worshiping the Lord? Sometimes something I try to do every once in a while when I have my prayer time is I won't ask for anything. I'll just spend the whole time in worshiping God and reflecting back on who God is and praising Him and thanking Him and not ask for anything. It isn't wrong to ask for things, but worship needs to be a major part there as well. Prosuko. Intercession, Paul says, that requests and prayers and intercession. The Greek word there is entousix. Entousix. Praying for others' needs. Praying for others' needs. Intercession. You understand what intercession is. Let's just say Eunice and Nancy get to bickering with one another, and they're going to, right in the service, they're going to stand up and they're going to start duking it out. You know, while I'm up here and I see that, and I don't want that to break out right in the middle of our service. So while I'm preaching, I might even walk back, "Hey, hold on. I am interceding in a need there, huh?" That should be the idea of prayer. You have a lost friend and he needs the Lord. You can intercede and you can talk to your friend about the Lord, but you can talk to the Lord about your friend. Somebody's in the hospital or has some real financial needs. We pray, praying for the needs of other people. Several of the commentaries brought this out, that the idea of intercession kind of has the idea of a conversation. Our prayers should be so natural to us that they're like a conversation with the Lord. You know, "Oh, Deacon Jones, will you stand and lead us in prayer?" "Our Heavenly Father, Thou hast bestowed upon us the great..." You know, we don't talk like that with our friends. That's not a conversation. conversations you have with people that you're friends and you talk your normal language and you can bear things, you can tell things to them that you wouldn't share with other people, you know? And that's kind of hidden in this word intercession, coming to the Lord and praying for others and asking in a very close conversational way, talking with the Lord. You know, Lord, I got this friend. He's got this problem. You know him better than I do. And Lord, I really pray for him. I want you to work in his life, interceding for others. I want to talk about that. We're going to have a whole sermon on that. You look at, for example, and we'll come to this maybe in a couple weeks. Paul prays for the Ephesians, okay? And he does not, you read his prayer. Paul does not mention one of the physical needs of the Ephesians. Doesn't mention it at all. But he prays for spiritual needs in their life. A lot of times, our prayer, you know, the old joke about churches used to have Wednesday night, they'd have prayer meeting, and they'd take prayer requests, and it became what they called an organ recital, because everyone would raise their hand, my Aunt Matilda's in the hospital with a bad bunions, or my Uncle George is in the hospital with kidney problems, you know, they call it an organ recital. Now, there's nothing wrong with praying for people who have health problems or physical needs. Nothing wrong with that. But here's something for you to think about. Maybe the Lord brought that physical need into their life for a purpose. Maybe the Lord wants them to become more dependent on Him. Maybe the Lord wants them to seek Him more. Maybe our prayers for other people as we intercede should be something like, Lord, you are in control. And Lord, I don't know why he's in the hospital, but you have a purpose in it. May his heart be open to your purpose. We should pray more for the spiritual aspects than we do the physical aspects when we intercede for others. Lord, I want you to heal them and get them out of the hospital as quickly as possible. And the Lord says, no, that's not my plan for their life. I have a purpose in this. Sometimes, you know, Peter was going to defend the Lord, and Jesus turned around and rebuked him. Get behind me, Satan. Whoa, those are pretty strong words. Why? Because Peter didn't want to fulfill the will of the Lord. He was seeking, you know, what he thought was the important thing. So many times in our prayer lives, we do that. We pray about what we think are the important things. Intercession maybe ought to be, Lord, be working in their life spiritually. Bring them to you. Help them to realize this. Help them to grow from this experience in their life. So intercession, requests, prayers, intercessions, and thanksgiving. Eucharistos is the Greek word. Eucharistos, that sounds familiar. If you were a Catholic, that would sound very familiar. What is that? What is the Eucharist? That's what the Catholic Church calls their Lord's Supper, the Eucharist, right? Well, it comes from the Greek word dealing with thanksgiving. We have a name, Karen means a gift, charis. Carissa, have you ever heard the name Carissa? Comes from the Greek word dealing with thanksgiving. Eucharist, thanking God. The U on the front of it is a prefix in Greek meaning good. When you go to a funeral and everyone starts talking good things about them, that's called the eulogy. Well, that comes from the Greek prefix eu meaning good. Thanking God for the good things that He has blessed us with. Being thankful for what God has already blessed us with. That should be a part of our prayer. That should be an important part of our prayer. You know, again, we come busting into to God's presence and we say, Lord, I need this and I want help with that and I need this and I want help with that. Well, what about worship And what about thanking him for all of the stuff that he has already given to us? I tried to get that across on Thanksgiving Sunday about, you know, there's so many things in our lives that we just take for granted that we don't realize are wonderful, wonderful blessings from the Lord. We need to spend time in thanksgiving to the Lord. So here's some, Paul says, first of all, Timothy, I want these things to be started being done to get this church in Ephesus straightened around. Number one, let people pray their desperate prayers, their requests. Number two, act of worship. Worship the Lord in your prayer life. Number three, intercession, praying for in a very close and intimate way with the Lord, praying for the needs of other people. And number four, spend time thanking the Lord for what he has already given to you. So, those are some things that should be included in our prayer. Question number three, who should we pray for? That's an important part of this text. Okay, so here's the verse. 1b it starts out with. Prayers, first of all, Timothy, prayers should be made for everyone. All right, so last part of that. He says, for kings and all those in authority that we may live peaceful and quiet lives in all godliness and holiness. I skipped verse 3, though that was a good one. This is God's will. Then verse 4, who want all men to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. Okay, so who should we pray for? Laid out pretty clearly here, huh? Number one, everyone. There's a big task. But you know what? This is a lesson. I think you can see it in Scripture, but I learned in prayer. The Lord likes specific prayers. You know, if we say, Lord, bless all of the missionaries around the world as they preach your gospel. Well, what about getting to know some missionaries and getting to know them well and praying for their particular needs that they may have? We have had prayer guides for needs of foreign, this season, foreign missionaries, some of the specific prayer requests and praying for them. Now, I was reading somewhere, and a guy, in fact, it was that sermon, Prayer for Beginners, the guy talks about here, pray for everyone. And he says, what you need to do is develop your concentric circles. Now, what does he mean by that? Well, what he means by that is we can't. Time don't permit us to pray for everybody. So we should begin to pray for those who are most important in our lives and build concentric circles about our prayers and gradually work out. I pray every day. I pray every day for my wife. I love my wife very much, and I pray for the Lord's blessing and spiritual growth. I pray for that she'll have patience to put up with that rotten husband she's got, you know. I pray for my wife. I pray for my grandkids. You know, you grandparents here know how important they are in your life, you know. I pray for them. They're going to grow up in a world. I think about the world that they're going to grow up in that's entirely different than the world I grew up in. When they get 40, 50 years old, what's the world going to be like? What's the United States? What's the social culture going to be like where they are growing up in? I pray, and my son is following the Lord, he and his wife, they take him to Sunday school and church, and they're teaching him some important things, and I pray that those two little girls, one is six, I got to work my grandkids in almost every sermon, one is six, one is two, almost six, she's five, almost six, I pray for them every day that they'll come to know the Lord. I have a daughter who has wandered from the Lord, doesn't know the Lord Jesus Christ, though she respects us, knew she was grown up in a Christian home. I pray for her and her husband that they will have a radical conversion and come to the Lord Jesus Christ. That's kind of my inner circle. I pray for my local church. I pray for this church. And this church, you know, one of the things about this church is small enough that I can pray for almost every family in the church in my prayer time, you know. Those pastors that got thousands, they don't know hardly anybody, you know. I pray for this local church. I pray that we'll have the Lord's vision and direction. I pray for our outreach programs. I pray for the needs in you guys' lives. And then I go out from there. We have some very close missionary friends that run an AIDS orphanage in South Africa. We have visited them a couple of times. I pray for Phil and Alana Carmichael every day. Part of my concentric circles. I don't want to rehash my whole prayer life here, but just to point out, we pray for those things that have the highest priorities in our life and then begin to work out from there. Pray for everyone. Secondly, one of the specific things that the Apostle Paul writes to Timothy is you need to be having these Ephesians begin to pray for the king, the Caesar of the time, and all those in authority. There is an important group for us to pray about. We just had an election. In a couple of days, we're going to be having a changing of administration. And I'm not going to get into, you know, political, whether who you for here today. But you know what? Even if you don't like the guy, either one of the two guys, you should be praying for them. Praying for, you know, we do, as Christians, we do more bashing of our leaders than we do praying about them. We need to be in prayer for them. Pray for all of those in authority. By the way, who are our two senators from the state of Michigan? Levin is one of them. I think so. Or is she a congresswoman? We ought to know this. My point is, we ought to know this. We should be praying for them. Here's what I pray, I know, I don't remember them either, but I pray for the Senate and the congressmen. I pray that they would have biblical wisdom as they establish laws in this land. I think that that's a good prayer. That they would have biblical wisdom. You know what? There's going to be a Supreme Court. Oh, we're going to have a big fight. Trump's going to choose a conservative. You know, it's kind of interesting because the Supreme Court was set up to not be Republican or Democrat. It was to be totally neutral. They're in for life. But it has progressed, or I should say regressed, so that the more liberal presidents nominate more liberal judges and the conservative presidents nominate more conservative judges. You know, everyone in the country knows that that's going on. But you know what? We should pray for the Supreme Court. They have an immense power in this nation, even more so than the legislature, of declaring constitutional or unconstitutional laws. Pray for the Supreme Court. All those in authority, pray for your police officers. They have a tough job. In the last couple years, we have seen some real things, changes in the United States. And police officers have a very tough, difficult job. We should pray for those. Paul says that we should pray for those who are in authority. Now, why does Paul want us to pray for those people? Well, be interesting if in the book of Ephesians, Paul says, that's a prison epistle. Paul said that he's had the opportunity to witness to some of the household of Caesar, and some had come to know the Lord Jesus as their Savior. You know, anyway, so that should be one reason we pray for those. But he tells us why we should pray for those. Pray for the kings and all those in authority, that we may live peaceful and quiet lives in all godliness and holiness, so that Christians are not under persecution and that we can go about evangelizing and sharing the gospel and living holy, godly lives throughout the United States, living godly lives, evangelizing people, seeing people to come to know the Lord without government stopping us and persecuting us. By the way, Paul had been in prison, as he writes 1 Timothy. He had been, most Bible scholars believe that he was out of prison, again, from the book of Acts, and the book of Acts ends him with his rented house and probably was released and wrote 1 Timothy. Then in 2 Timothy, we find the Apostle Paul again back in prison and had been tried, and it looked like he was going to be martyred, and tradition holds that he was martyred there shortly after he wrote 2 Timothy. Paul is telling us to pray that Christianity can continue to share the gospel in the United States without government harassment and persecution. We are seeing, as you all know, some things happen. There are Christians who, I won't go into that, but we need to pray. That's one of the reasons we should pray for those who are in government, is so that Christians can continue to live the Christian life in this nation. Now, thirdly, notice what he says there, verse 4. He says, God, verse 3 talks about, for this is the will of God. It is God's will and pleasing to God that you pray. And he says, who wants all men to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth? God wants us to pray for the lost. God wants us to pray for the lost. I want to ask you something. Do you have, in your prayer time, a list of unsaved people that you are praying for regularly? You ought to do that. Don't have to be a whole lot of them, but get a list of some lost people and begin to pray for them regularly. Pray that the Lord will open the eyes of their understanding. They are spiritually blind. If they haven't accepted Jesus Christ, they are spiritually blind at this point. Pray that God will open the eyes of their understanding and that they will come to know Jesus Christ as their Savior. You should be praying for those on a regular basis. So, pray for everyone. Remember our concentric circles there? Pray for those who are in authority. And thirdly, pray for lost people. Pray that they'll come to know the Lord Jesus Christ as their Savior. The who of this passage, all right, I'm summarizing it here. Pray for everyone who has need, those in leadership, and the unsaved. All right, question number, cross-reference, 1 Thessalonians 5. Rejoice always. I preached a sermon one time called Little Short Verses That Mean a Whole Lot. And that's what these are. Little short verses, this is where this comes from. Little short verses that mean a lot. So he says, rejoice evermore, or always. By the way, that word rejoice there is a command, it is a verb, and it is a command, you know? I have to keep telling myself this. In those evenings when I get grumpy and I get ornery and I get mad, those stinking Lions lost last night in the middle of that game, I got so mad! I had to say to myself, John, the Bible says rejoice. Whether you feel like it or not, it is a command for you to do it. Rejoice. Secondly, it says pray without ceasing. Whoa. Keep praying. You know, pray for everyone? Well, that's what you got to do. Okay, I'm going to head out. Let's see. Lord, I want you to help so-and-so. Lord, I want you to help so-and-so. And all through the day, you're praying for people. Huh? Pray without ceasing. Now, some Bible scholars have said, I don't know that means, you know, be a monk and get up in the morning and go pray for 15 hours a day and then get a few hours sleep and then come back and pray for 15 hours a day. But pray as you go throughout the day for needs and for people. Have that conversational prayer with the Lord. That's what's so fun about reading the book of Nehemiah. Nehemiah is building this wall, and he's having problems with those people who want him to stop building the wall. And as they're in the middle of building the wall, Nehemiah in the book, he just prays for them, and he prays for the workers, and he prays for, and it's just kind of conversational prayers as he goes throughout his daily life. Pray without ceasing. Give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. Wow. Those are three tough, little short, easy verses, but really tough things for us to do, huh? Rejoicing, even when we don't feel like it. Praying all the time, keep praying, and then give thanks in all circumstances. Huh? Whew. All right. Oh, and brother, later on in the chapter, he says, in 1 Thessalonians 5, he says, brothers, pray for us. Paul wanted the churches to regularly be praying for him. You know what? It says in the book of Hebrews, I'm going to be selfish here. It says in the book of Hebrews that you should pray for your spiritual leaders, those of you who are those for those who are over you in the Lord. I want you to pray for me regularly, daily. Pray for Pastor Herrick, if you will. All right, let's go on. Question number four. What enables us to pray? We got awesome, infinite God who created the whole universe, which goes for billions and billions and billions of light years, and there are planets, and there are stars, and there are suns, and there's this little tiny globe, third planet from the sun, third rock from the sun, and on it there are what's the world population? Billion, 6 billion people. I don't remember what it is, and we can utter a silent thought from our heart, and God hears it and wants to hear it and will grant our requests. What? Who ever thought that? Wow. If you ever stop and think about what prayer is, what an amazing thing prayer is. For there is one God and one mediator between man men and man, the man, bleh. For there is one God and one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus. Jesus Christ has become the mediator before us and God. God is a holy God. We are sinners. Jesus died on the cross and rose again and ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand, God of cross reference. He sits at the right hand of God and intercedes for us, who gave himself as a ransom for all men. That was not a ransom. There are those who hold a theology that Jesus was a ransom paid to the devil to buy us back from the devil. That isn't what he ransomed. He ransomed us from a holy God that we had a sin debt against, because we have sin in our lives. And as Jesus died on the cross, he bought us back. Cross-reference, Romans 8:34. Who is he that condemns? Christ Jesus, who died. More than that, he is raised to life, is at the right hand of God, and is also interceding for us. Jesus intercedes for us. What gives us the right to think that we could talk to the great, holy, awesome God of this universe? The fact that he loved us and that Jesus Christ died for us and intercedes for us. Another cross-reference, I won't go through this in detail, but it talks about how the Holy Spirit also helps us in our prayer. So God the Father hears our prayers, Jesus intercedes in our prayer life, and the Holy Spirit helps us as well in our prayers. All right, what can hinder our prayers? Oh, and I'm going to have a whole sermon on things that can hinder our prayers, but in this passage, the Apostle Paul talks about one of them. He says here, I want men everywhere to lift up holy hands in prayer. Verse 8, jump down to verse 8. And then he says, without anger or disputing, without anger or disputing. I want you to be able to pray without having personal relationship problems with others. Cross-reference, 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 7. This is kind of interesting. He says, husbands, in the same way, be considerate as you live with your wives, and treat them with respect as the weaker partner and as heirs with you of the gracious gift of life. And then Peter adds this. This is really interesting. Peter adds this on the end. Okay, husbands, respect your wives. Treat them right. Do your husbandly responsibilities, so that nothing will hinder your prayers. Implied in that is your prayers will be hindered if you have personal, interpersonal relationship problems with your wife. That verse up above, having anger and disputing with others. When you come to prayer, Jesus says, when you bring your gift to the altar. And he says, you have a problem with somebody else. You need to leave your gift there, leave the altar, and go get that interpersonal relationship problem that you have with somebody else, get that taken care of, and then come back and offer your gift to the Lord. I think that applies to prayer as well. We need to get these interpersonal relationship problems that we have, either with fellow Christians or even with unsaved people, We need to show them the love of the Lord Jesus Christ, or our prayers can be hindered. That's not the only hindrance to prayer, but that's the one that was here in this text. I'm going to have a sermon in the future talking about hindrances that we may have in our prayer life, causing our prayers not to be answered. Okay, so what can hinder our prayers? Interpersonal relationship problems. Yesterday, I got up, had my morning devotions and our daily bread like normal. I want to read that to you because it was specifically about prayer. Interesting story. In August 2010, the attention of the world was focused on a mine shaft near Copiapo, Chile. 33 miners huddled in the dark, trapped 2,300 feet underground. They had no idea if help would ever arrive. Remember when that happened? Everyone was hearing about those miners that were trapped in Chile. After 17 days of waiting, now they had had some provisions that were down there that they were rationing and stuff, but 17 days went by. After 17 days of waiting, they heard drilling. Rescuers produced a small hole in the mine shaft ceiling, and that hole was followed by three more, establishing a delivery path for water, food, and medicine. The miners depended on those conduits to the surface above the ground where the rescuers had provisions they would need to survive. After day 69, rescuers pulled the last miner out of the shaft to safety. And it goes on to say, none of us can survive in this world apart from provisions that are outside of ourselves. God, the creator of the universe, is the one who provides us with everything we need. And like those holes drilled for those miners, prayer connects us to the God of this universe. I hope you don't get bored with a whole long series, 6 months or so, on prayer. But I hope it encourages you and helps you grow in your prayer life. What is your prayer life like? Do you pray for your leaders? Do you pray and intercede for others? Do you have broken relationships that are hindering your prayer life that you need to get taken care of? How's your prayer life? Let's bow in prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you for this morning. Thank you that we can come to the God of this universe in prayer, and you hear us and you answer our prayers, Father. What an amazing thing that is. I pray, Lord, that you will just help us in our prayer life to grow and to improve in that, Lord. May this series of sermons help us and encourage us in that. Father, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.